and said, "Go into the village ahead of you. As you enter it, you will find a young donkey tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent left and found it just as he told them. As they were untying the young donkey, its owner said to them, "Why are you untying the donkey?" "The Lord needs it," they said. Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their robes on the donkey, they helped Jesus get on it. As he was going along, they were spreading their robes on the road. Now he came near the path down the Mount of Olives, and the whole crowd of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees from the crowd told him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, "I tell you, if they were to keep silent, the stones would cry out." So ends the reading of God's holy word. Please stand and sing the next song, "When the Cheering Stops." Nope, "At Your Name, Yahweh." Sorry, gave you the message title. We could sing that too, couldn't we?
Again, nice to see everyone on Palm Sunday. Anybody know what on that last song, how they came up with God's name, Yahweh? Anybody ever heard this story? That's because there isn't one. In ancient Hebrew language, they did not have any vowels. So all they had was, what do you call the other ones, consonants? Yeah. Anyway, so somebody came up with the idea of let's put a vowel in the middle here and a vowel in the middle over there, and they came up with Yahweh. Because we don't know how to pronounce it with just the letters without vowels. All right. Well, several years ago, a book was written by an American author who was also a best-selling author, and his name was Gene Smith. And Gene Smith wrote a book that was also a bestseller, and it was titled, "When the Cheering Stops." And it was all about the President of the United States and what was happening in the world, and particularly with his office, Woodrow Wilson, talking about what was going on before and immediately after World War One, some of you may recall that World War I was oftentimes referred to as the war that's going to end all wars. But we know that didn't happen. But something very strange occurred on an international level. There was a whole bunch, a ton of optimism after that war. One, likely because it was the war that ended all wars, and they believed that. And so that brought a lot of optimism. And they thought then that the world would actually be more safe. The world would have democracy as almost a worldwide form of government. So the people were very, very excited about this. The upshot of it, one of the upshots of it, is Woodrow Wilson, who became a hero. He was applauded and literally worshipped everywhere he went. In fact, there were stories many times of children that were in hospitals. The nurses would explain to the children that, hey, this year we're just not going to have any presents at Christmas time. And the kids responded with, oh, yes, we are. Woodrow Wilson's coming to town, and he'll get us Christmas. I mean, it just, everybody thought the world of Woodrow Wilson. People thought Woodrow Wilson was a hero. Bigger and brighter than the heroes that everybody had in their own country. It was just amazing how the time immediately following World War I, Woodrow Wilson was idolized and praised. Now the cheering for Woodrow Wilson, the applause, the excitement, lasted just shy of 1 year. It then gradually began to slow down and stop. As you might suspect, after the war, the political leaders in Europe, for example, were more concerned about their own agendas than they were concerned about a lasting peace. And a lasting peace is exactly what Woodrow Wilson symbolized for everyone. At home, here in the United States, Wilson was doing very well, not as well as he was doing overseas. But the problem that Wilson had here was that he could not get the United States Senate to ratify his League of Nations concept. It's kind of like the UN going in, but not quite. As Wilson's health then began to deteriorate because of the stress at home, the stress he faced when the Senate would not ratify his League of Nations idea, that it went on for a month or two, and Wilson suffered a debilitating stroke. Wilson, a man who barely a year earlier had been heralded as the new world Messiah, came to the end of his life as a broken and defeated man. It was a very sad, sad story. But one that is not unfamiliar with each of us. It happened exactly the same way to Jesus. When he first began his ministry, he became very popular very quickly with the people in the countryside. In fact, using today's terms, Jesus became an overnight sensation. He would try at times to go off to be alone, and the people followed him. They would not give him any rest. When Jesus tried to get away, they followed. Now, Jesus needed this time alone, however, but any time that the crowds followed him, Jesus would turn and talk with them and perform a number of miracles for them. Now, it's important that we understand that Jesus knew how all of these things was going to play out in his life. He knew the crowds and his acceptance by them long before he actually began his ministry. He also knew about the cross in Jerusalem. We know that he knows because of the prayers that Jesus prayed in the garden right before his execution. Can you imagine how you would respond on how you would live your life if you knew exactly how it was going to all play out? And you also knew when it was going to play out. Now, on Palm Sunday, palm branches were spread before him as he was coming into Jerusalem from Bethany, and shouts of Hosanna, which means shouts of praise and joy. The people simply adored him. In shouting Hosanna, they were in effect saying, "Save us now, Jesus." Huge crowds came to hear him preach. A wave of spirituality spread across the country rapidly. As this was all happening, of course, Jesus was talking about spirituality. Jesus was talking about the kingdom of God. But ultimately, what the crowd wanted was someone that could do away with Rome. Somebody that will be their prince, that would come on a horse and free the people and save the people from Rome. Sadly now, the cheering didn't last very long. There came a point when the tide began to do an about face, to turn on Jesus. Oh, it wasn't something that you or him would notice in the beginning or at first. People still came to see him, but the excitement just wasn't quite there, and the crowds were not as large as they used to be. His critics now began to publicly attack him. There was something new, or that was something new. Earlier, they had been afraid to speak because they were actually afraid of the masses. They were afraid of the crowds themselves. Before it was all over, a tidal wave welled up that brought Jesus to his knees because of the weight of the cross. One might ask, why did these masses so radically turn against him? How in the world does anyone go from shouts of Hosanna on Sunday, 5 days later, they're yelling, crucify him, on Friday? What were the underlying issues that were so deep that the crowd wanted his blood? In just 5 days, it all fell apart. Why did that happen? Why? Well, that, folks, is the issue of our focus this morning. Perhaps we will be able to find some answers to the question that we had in the beginning. Why did the cheering begin to stop? There are three events that we need to take a look at this morning as to why the cheering slowed down and stopped. Three events, all of which contributed to Jesus' popularity waning away. Now, the first one we're going to look at, one reason why the cheering stopped is that Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. During the last week of Jesus' life, a very interesting scene occurred. A rich young ruler came literally running up to Jesus, so excited, wanting to know from him, what would it take, or what does it take, to have eternal life? Now, everything that Jesus is doing at this time, everything is done in front of all the people. It's no discussion ever taking place one-on-one. It is always out in the open. You all may remember this parable that takes place during between Palm Sunday and Good Friday. So you know the conversation and how it went. But essentially, Jesus said, go and sell everything you own, give it to the poor, and then follow me. The masses were stunned because the masses were under the belief that a rich man was blessed by God, and he, the rich man, should be looked at in a positive way. So they were stunned when Jesus said, give away all of your money, give away your assets. They had been raised to believe that these people were actually chosen by God. Yet here is Jesus turning the big money away, turning his back on the money. They were bothered also for a second reason. Prior to this, Jesus' message had largely been one of grace. For example, the feeding of the 5,000 was all grace. He was able to feed them. And when the people brought their sick family members to Jesus, he would heal them. When a woman was caught in adultery and about to be stoned, Jesus is the one who comes to her rescue and saves her. The message of his ministry is all about grace upon grace until now. Now he seems to be saying the time for miracles is over. The time for commitment is now. It's interesting to note that in all four Gospels, the shouts of Hosanna when he first enters on Palm Sunday, over half of their book, of the four books, takes up the time frame from Palm Sunday to Easter, actually. So the gospel writers were paying a lot of attention to that portion of Jesus' life and how important it was. Now is the time for commitment. There are some events that we might, of course, count as miracles, but he did not perform any miracle to save someone or to help someone. Jesus was hungry one morning, and on his way to where he was going, he stops by a fig tree and hopes to find figs that he could eat. As you know, the tree was barren. There were no figs on the tree. And what did Jesus do when that happened? He killed the fig tree. It withered. It went away. And the reason for that is that Jesus demands fruitful and committed lives to him. Now, there's another parable that is told about who is more committed. The son who says, "I will work," and then does not, or the son who says, "I will not work," but eventually repents, changes his mind, and he gets the job done. Of course, it's the person that gets the job done. The greatest commandment is given during this time. Love God and neighbor. His teachings that he has regarding that particular commitment says that we are to be watchful, for we do not know the day or hour of his return is also there. Now, after the triumphant entry everywhere, Jesus asked for that commitment. And he asked for devotion from the people, and what he heard in response, I would say that he did not like what he was hearing. Jesus saw when the rich young ruler walked away sorrowfully, he was not the only one to walk that way. It is safe to assume that a ton of uncommitted people also walked away. When it came to committing to what Jesus was saying, people would walk away. Jesus no longer talking about grace. He was now speaking the other side of religion, and that is obligation. He began to talk about the obligation that rests with a person who has accepted God's grace. The cheering began to stop when Jesus began to talk about commitment. That's number one. Number two. Next, the cheering stopped when Jesus dared to suggest that all people, everybody, are worth loving. In John's Gospel, look what happens on Palm Sunday. Jesus goes to the temple and does what? Throws the bums out, the money changers, threw them out. And then the next thing he did was to invite so-called street people into the temple to worship. The poor, it was the poor, the lame, the sick, and the outcasts of society. The church, those who would refer to today as the seedy street people, if you will. Why Jesus? That is not the way to, of course, win friends and influence people. By bringing in these people was his way of saying all people have access to God. In his way, it's a way of saying that this is what the kingdom of God is going to be like. Now that Jesus makes his triumphant entry into the city, and there are shouts of Hosanna, blessed be the Son of David. But look at who is in the temple and is yelling that proclamation or that invitation to Jesus. We are told in Matthew that it's none other than the children. It is the children who are giving under the skin of the Pharisees. They ask Jesus at this point, do you hear what they're saying? Are you going to allow that, Jesus? Do you not deny this? Jesus says, well, as Bonnie read this, Jesus said, if I tried to quiet them, the very stones would scream it and cry out. The point is that it is that time again when the powerless people, the children and maybe the weak, who recognize Jesus' messiahship, those who have power resist it. They resist the messiahship. Why did the cheering stop? Because on Palm Sunday, Jesus opened the doors of the church to everyone. And it angered some people. Number three, and the last one. the cheering stopped because Jesus began to talk more and more about the cross. In the early part of his ministry, Jesus talked about the kingdom of God. This is what people wanted to hear, especially since they misunderstood the kingdom to be a restoration of Israel to the days of King David's glory. But increasingly, Jesus just began to talk about sacrifice in the form of the cross, talking about giving up your life as your commitment. A story is told about a peewee baseball game. The young boy got up to bat, and the coach, who was giving signals to the batters, signaled to the young lad to sacrifice bunt. In other words, make it so you're out. Well, the first pitch came, and the youngster swung as hard as he could. Second pitch came, and it was the same thing. The kid swung as hard as he could. And guess what he did on the third one? He swung as hard as he could. All three of them, he missed. The coach comes up to him afterwards and says, "You were looking my way. Didn't you see the signal I was sending for a sacrifice bunt?" And the kid says, "Yeah, I saw it. I didn't think you meant it." Sometimes we feel that way and we want to say that to God. "Yes, Lord, I heard that talk about sacrifice. You betcha. But I didn't really think that you meant it." The cross says emphatically, "He did mean it." Well, this message began with a question. Why did the cheering stop? It stopped because Jesus more and more began to talk about commitment. It stopped because Jesus opened up the doors of the church and invited everyone to come in. But most importantly, it stopped because Jesus began talking about a cross. Amen. If we could have our ushers, please. Thank you, ma'am. Well, that last week of Jesus' life was just packed full of stuff. It was probably the reason that I'm supposed to be reading a prayer right now, but he was so upset. So why don't I do that as long as you follow along with the screen? Sorry. God help us to discover new and bold ways to connect family and the people in our community. Give us courage to heed your call to serve your world. And God, open our hearts and hands to love and care for our church family and those in our community, just as you love and cared for us unconditionally. Amen. Like I was saying, that last week was just packed full of Jesus being heralded and praised more than actually he ever had before. And that within 5 days got him to the cross. Just an amazing turn of events. Would you please join us for our final song, Blessed Be Your Name. Thank you.